Thank you so much for joining us, everyone. We are in Parshat Shoftim. We'll start right from the very beginning. Dvarim Tetzayin Yudchet Shoftim Vishotrim Titein Lecha Bechol She'arecha. Moshe Rabbeinu tells the Jewish people they have to have judges, they have to have policemen there in all of their gates to make sure that there is a system of protecting people when things are done wrong. Judges, policemen, you'll have a civilized society. Says the Shlach HaKadosh regarding the words, having the judges and the policemen in all of your gates. It's a very interesting terminology. Sheva She'arim B'Nefesh. He quotes the Sefer Yetzirah. There are seven different gateways into the soul. Shtei Oznayim, you have the two ears. Shtei Einayim, you have two eyes. Shnei Nechirei Af, you have the two nostrils. Hapeh and the mouth. Those are the seven. Shedarkam Ovrim. That is how we intake information. That is how we experience things in the world, is through our eyes, through our ears, through our mouth, through our nose. Those are where the senses come from. The Omar Zal Katu says the Shlach HaKadosh. The Pasuk says, Shoftim v'shotrim titein lecha b'chol she'arecha. What does that mean? Tasim lev. Pay attention. Shederech ha-she'arim halalim. That through your gateways, the gateways from the world into your soul, lo yavru kol divrei tiyu v'nivol, nothing abhorrent, no abominations should pass through. Ha'aznayim lo yishmu divrei bela, your ears should not hear things that they shouldn't be hearing. Ha'inayim, your eyes, lo yiru bara, should not be seeing things that they shouldn't be seeing. Ha'peh, lo yidaber tafuchot, the mouth should not speak things that it shouldn't speak. You're supposed to be a shofet and a shoter. You're supposed to be a policeman over your gates. This is an unbelievable teaching in terms of understanding the kol she'arecha. We live our lives and we're constantly being bombarded with all kinds of information and all kinds of things from the world around us. We're constantly hearing things, seeing things, we're saying things, we're engaging in conversations, we're even smelling things. The Torah has very clear prohibitions when it comes to what we see, what we hear, how we speak, but we live our lives very much on rote. We're just going through the motions and we're not really guarding ourselves from those things. Shoftim titein lecha b'chol she'arecha, according to the Shlach, is saying, if you want to be an Eved Hashem, you have to be someone who is constantly on guard. Or even better, you could say, you should put into place safeguards to make sure that you're not in situations where you're seeing, hearing things that you don't want to be seeing or hearing, that you're not in a company where you'll be saying things that you don't want to say. But the idea here is, take that extra step, and Moshe Feinstein goes in further and talks about guarding ourselves, being aware of what we're seeing and hearing and saying. Because so much of our lives are focusing on the do's and the don'ts of mitzvot when it comes to actions, or the do's and the don'ts when it comes to actions of avera, but we're not necessarily thinking about our daily interactions, our hourly interactions, where there can be so much wrong that's taking place as well. Put up those safeguards, be on guard, be conscious of the things that we're seeing, hearing, and saying, etc. That is Shoftim v'shotrim titein lecha b'chol she'arecha. The Kli Yakar, as we go to lesson number two, that was lesson number one, lesson number two, the Kli Yakar focuses on this pasuk as well, and he's bothered by the words titein lecha b'chol she'arecha. Let's go to the simple translation of this pasuk that is talking about the appointment of judges for society, that is talking about the appointment of these policemen, these authorities that are going to be overseeing everything that's happening. Why does it say lecha, to you? Of course, Moshe is telling the Jewish people that this is for you. Why that extra word lecha? Says the Kli Yakar, Bir ha'inyan hu, shepasuk zeh, he says, this pasuk, tzivoy lemi sheyesh safek biyado limnos dayanim, he says, who are we talking to here? Someone is going to be appointing judges and these policemen. Sheyimna otam, appoint them, amanat sheyu dayanim, that they will be judges even for you. You're a person of authority who is appointing the judges. Lecha, they have to be judges for you as well. V'lo yachnifu afilu lezeh amamuna otam, you might think that, wait a minute, if these judges are put in place by me, they're not going to judge me. I have control over them. I'm the one who put them in their position. I can get my way out of anything that comes up. No. Titen lecha al atzmecha. This has to be on you, on the leader who's appointing the judges. They are going to be judges. One of the words that come afterwards, if you appoint the judges for you, that you are bound to their decisions as well, and you can't get out of it because you appointed them, then you're going to have judgments that are judges and judgments that are tzedek, that are just, that are right. That's going to be the automatic response that comes if you, as the one who's appointed the judges, make sure that you are under their authority as well. That's lesson number two. We live in a world where very often the leaders don't feel that they are subject to the decisions of the very people who they put into place, because I put them into place. When you appoint judges, when you appoint leaders, when you appoint whatever position it is, you are also bound by the rules. You are bound by the rules of the game. You are bound by their decisions. And then you'll have tzedek. Then you'll have justice in the society. If we're in a world where the authorities who appoint people to positions are bound by the rules, then we're no longer living in a society of tzedek. Lesson number two. Lesson number three. Moving on to Dvarim Tetzayin Yutet. Ki ha-shochad ye'aver einecha chamim. Bribery can blind the eyes of the wise. Misalev divei tzadikim. It'll take the righteous people and take them totally off course. We always talk about this pasuk in terms of the negative, that you have to have judges who won't take bribes. The Sfat Emet takes us to a whole different place. He says, Mikan yish limod kal v'chomer. We're going to learn something from this. Im negia yish bakedei la'avret einayim. He says, if on the negative side, people can be blinded. Harei mikol shekein mida tova maruba mida parandu. We have a concept that the positive forces can always outweigh the negative forces. What does that mean over here? Shame Adam Mesalik Me'al Atzmo. If a person removes from himself at Kol Hanagiyot all of the personal wants, V'hapniot, V'torach, L'Devachor, instead of you get rid of all the distractions that don't allow you to do good, Einav Nifkachos U'Ma'oros L'Hasik L'Havin Emes. You will be able to see the truth. Let's go through this again. The Torah tells us that judges, even the greatest of people, are subject to bribery, and they have to stay far away from it because the greatest of people can be distracted and taken off course by bribes. It says this Sfat Emet, if that's the truth in the negative, in the positive, all the more so. If you remove all those quote-unquote bribes, you remove all the factors that are distractions in our life from what's truly important, you're going to hit the truth. You're going to grow on the greatest level spiritually, because if it takes you off course on the negative side, certainly doing the opposite will help you on the positive side. We have to sit and do a cheshbon hanefesh, do a real internal reflection, and understand what are those things in my life that distract me from the spiritual, from what's truly important. Work hard to remove them. And then all of a sudden, the truth will be there. Just like the bribery takes the person off course, removing those bribes, so to speak, will put you on course. As the Gemara says in Sota, Gimel Amud Aleph, Ein Adam Over Aveira, a person only sins, Ela Imke Nichnas Bo Ruach Shtut, if a spirit of insanity comes over him. What is the Gemara saying? The Gemara is saying that if we would find a way to remove all the distractions and remove all those things that take us off course, the insanity, so to speak, you won't sin, because you'll see the truth right in front of you. What we have to do is the hard work of sifting through what in our life is pulling us off course, what in our life is bribing us, so to speak, because it's dangling something in front of us which we think is so enticing, but it's actually taking us off course. And therefore, lesson number three, keep your eye on the ball. Don't be distracted by the physical world that pulls us away. Be aware of the fact that we're being distracted by just our selfish, personal, physical wants. And then once we remove that from the picture, we'll be able to live with truth. We'll be able to live as true Ovdei Hashem. Lesson number 4. Dvarim Yud Zayin Tetvav. Som Tasim Alecha Melech. Moshe Rabbeinu gives the command that the Jewish people should have a king. Now we fast forward later on the Torah to Shmuel, and we see that when the Jewish people asked for a king, it wasn't a positive thing. And the commentaries have to deal with why. The Torah says that you should have a king. What was the problem with them asking for a king? It's in line with what the Torah says. Says the Ketav Sofer, Lekach Yitra'im Shmuel al Yisrael. This is why Shmuel got angry with the Jewish people. Kishebikshu limnot aleihem melech, when they wanted to appoint a king. When they shamru, what did they say? Ata sima lanu melech, give us a king, kechol hagoyim, like all of the nations around us. Shmuel Aleph, Perikhet, Pasuk Hei. Lo ratzu l'kayim mitzvot haTorah, they didn't want to fulfill the laws of the Torah. What did they want? They didn't want to have the rules of the Torah. They wanted to be like all the nations of the world around us. Not to be Ovdei Hashem, not to fulfill the Ratzon Hashem, God's will, but rather it was because they wanted to be like all of the nations of the world. That is where the Avera was. Yes, Hashem says in the Torah, Som Tasim Alecha Melech, that you should have a king. But that's to have a king to help you in your Avodat Hashem. But over here, what happens? They wanted to have a king like all the nations of the world. That is not the way we're supposed to act. It says in Shemot, Yud Tet Vav, Va'atem Tiyuli, Mamlechet Kohanim V'goy Kadosh. What are the Jewish people supposed to be? Mamlechet Kohanim, a kingdom of priests. Goy Kadosh, a holy nation that's separate for the rest of the world. And this is where the Jewish people failed by saying they wanted to have a king, kechol hagoyim. This is an issue which we have at all times, where there's this enticement in the world around us. There's so much that seems like it's so good in the outside world, and the Jewish people are pulled to want to be like them. And it's supposed to be the exact opposite. We're supposed to be that or lagoyim, that light that inspires the entire world around us, and they want to be like us. We're supposed to be bringing spirituality to the world, and people will want to be like the Jewish people, but unfortunately, we want to be kechol hagoyim, and that pulls us off course as a people, and it pulls us off course as individuals. And lesson number 4 is we have to strive to be a special nation, to be special people who bring the world to follow our ways, instead of our following the ways of the world. This requires a constant assessment on an individual, on a national level, of what are we doing? What is determining our actions? Is it following the Torah, or is it following the world around us? And this command of Som Tasim Alecha Melech, and what happens at the end of the story, should remind us to make sure that we're not living our lives with that desire of to be Kechol HaGoyim like all the nations, but rather that we're living our lives to follow God's commandments, because that was God has told us to do, and hopefully the rest of the world will follow suit. Moving on to lesson number 5. Dvarim Yudchet Yud Gimel. Tamim Tihyeh Im Hashem Elokecha. You're supposed to be perfect. You're supposed to be pure with Hashem your God. What are those words, Im Hashem Elokecha, with God? Just say, you should be pure. You should be the perfect. Says the Al Shech HaKadosh. You know what it means when it says, Im Hashem Elokecha? Af b'chadrei chadarim. Even when you're in a room with no one else around, kishe'ein adam roa otcha. No one else sees you. Ata rak Im Hashem Elokecha. When you're there, all you are is with Hashem. There's no one else there, but God is there. Even in that case, when all you have is Hashem Elokecha bilvad, gam az. Even in that situation, Tamim Tiyeh Im Hashem Elokecha. You should strive to be perfect in your avodat Hashem. The Torah is telling us over here that it's human nature. When we're around other people, then we want to be tzaddikim, we want to be all righteous, we show people how wonderful we are. The Torah is telling us over here that you have to strive to be perfect, you have to strive to be tamim, to be pure, when you're just with Hashem alone, when there's no one around. That's the real test of an Eved Hashem. You know, the Rambam in Hilchot Yesod Torah Perek Hey talks about Kiddush Hashem and Chilul Hashem, sanctifying God's name and desecrating God's name. We grew up in a world, I certainly grew up this way, where we were always told that Chilul Hashem is when people out there in the world see something negative about Hashem, about a Jew, about the way that we act, about Torah. But the Rambam says that a Kiddush Hashem is not only that situation. Kol HaPoresh Me'Aveira, if you refrain from doing something wrong, O Asa Mitzvah, or you do a positive act. Lo b'nei davar ba'olam, not because of anything else in the world. Lo pachad, you're not afraid of anybody. Lo yira, there's no fear of what people will say. Lo mabakesh kavod, you're not seeking honor from the people who will see what you're doing. Ella, the only reason why you do it is b'nei habori borachu, it's from God. I'm with God, by myself in the room. Harei ze mekadesh et Hashem. You have the ability to sanctify God's name on the highest of levels when you are by yourself with no one else around. No one else will know that you're choosing to do this mitzvah or to refrain from doing this aveira. That is the highest level of Kiddush Hashem. That, according to Al-Sheikh, is what this Torah is saying, what Moshe is saying, when he says, Tamim tiyeb im Hashem Elokecha, when it's just you and God, no one else around, that's where you want to strive to be perfect. And that is lesson number 5. The true test of being an Eved Hashem is not how we act when we're in front of other people, because there, sadly, there are all kinds of other motivating factors which might be leading you to act in this way. But when you're by yourself, just with Hashem Elokecha, that's the true test, because then there's no ulterior motive. It's just purely for Hashem, and that's why it can be called Tamim, because whatever act that you're doing with such purity, because it's just you and Hashem. Lesson number 5, let's strive to be those Ovdei Hashem in the situation where it's just you and Hashem, where you are by yourself. Moving on to lesson number 6, Dvarim Yudchet Tetvav. Navi b'kibrecha be'achecha kamoni yakim lecha Hashem elokech. Moshe Rabbeinu tells the Jewish people, you are going to have prophets. And then he goes into all the rules about the prophets, you listen to him, etc. And we have rules about how to determine that someone is a true prophet. But notice the word what Moshe Rabbeinu says, you'll have a Navi, Mikir Becha, from amongst you, Me'achecha, from your brothers. Why does he have to say that extra word from your brothers? He just said that he's going to be from amongst you, that he'll be a human being that arises from amongst the people. Says his Fanemet, Me'achicha, Mitoch Ha'achva Shal Kalut B'nei Yisrael, Zochim L'Nevi'im. When it says Me'achicha, it's telling you, you have to be acting like brothers. If you, the Jewish people, are acting like brothers, then you can have a situation where a Navi, where a prophet will arise from among you. But if you're not acting like achicha, you're not acting like brothers with one another, you're not going to have that blessing of a prophet who Hashem sends your way. We've mentioned numerous times the benefits that come from Achdut, the benefits that come from the unity of the Jewish people. And over here, the Torah is telling us very clearly, the only chance you'll have of restoring prophecy is if you have unity, is if you're acting with each other as brothers. As Rav Kook says, and we've mentioned this numerous times, Ha'achlala shall call Am Yisrael, the gathering together of all the Jewish people, Kolel Ovrei Torah Mitzvot, even those people who we see as those who are not keeping Torah, Eina Rak Inyan Shal Achdut Pius. It's not just a nice ideal to strive for, Ella, but rather it's Mafteach L'Meshichan Hashefa Mishorash Neshamat Kol Yisrael. It's the key to open up all the brachot that Hashem can give to us. We cannot even open the door to the brachot from Hashem if we are not all of Am Yisrael together. And that's what it's saying over here about prophecy. It's saying you want to have prophets who can guide and lead the Jewish people based on the word of Hashem. The only chance you have of that coming is if you unlock that door of bracha from Hashem. And the key to unlock that door is me'achicha, is to, that we are acting as brothers with one another, that we have achdut. Lesson number 6, to recognize that achdut, that unity is the key to all of those brachot, including, we learned over here in this pasuk, including the restoration of prophecy to the Jewish people. Moving on to lesson number 7. Dvarim chaf yudtet. Kitatsur al ir yamim rabim, when you are besieging a city, you're going to be fighting against a certain city, people who have not agreed to peace with the Jewish people, and therefore we have to fight them. Tough, so you're going to capture the city. Lo tashchit et etzav, do not cut down its trees. Its trees, which give up fruit, are the source for life for your people, their food. You cannot just cut down the trees. This is a basis for understanding the basic Torah value that is caring for the environment, caring for the world that Hashem has created. And in an amazing midrash, in Kohelet Rabbah, it comes up in the Pasuk in Kohelet, in Perek Zayin, Pasuk in Gimel, the Medrash describes, B'shah shebarah kadosh baruch hu et Adam arishon. When God created Adam, not lo, he took Adam after creation. Remember, he's already created the whole world. Now he's created Adam. He takes Adam, ve'achziro al kol ilanei Gan Eden. He takes him over all the beautiful trees, all the beautiful creations of Gan Eden. Va'amar lo, and God says to Adam, re'em ma'asai, see my creations, kama noyim, how beautiful, u'mashavachim heim, and praiseworthy they are. See the incredible, beautiful creation. Tein daitcha, God says to Adam, pay attention, shol tekalkel v'tachrim et olami, do not destroy my world. Straight out, Hashem is saying, I've created this beautiful world as a Torah value. You have to be cautious to protect it and keep it as beautiful and keep it as something that's praiseworthy. Therefore, you can't just go chopping down trees. Trees are beautiful, beautiful. I had a chavrusa, an older gentleman I used to learn with in my building, Murray Kleinman, and he's in his 90s and he wasn't able to go out and about. And he talked about just how wonderful it was to wake up in the morning and just see the beautiful trees of the world. God has put them there for us to enjoy. And God says, don't destroy them. Take care of my environment. Lesson number 7, it's a Torah value to care for the world and do what we can to preserve the beauty of the world that God has created. Finally, lesson number 8. Dvarim Chaf Aleph, Vav and Zion. This is talking about the story of the Egla Arufa, the story where a person is found murdered between two cities. And the whole process they have to go through, including B'chol Ziknei Ha'irahi, all of the elders of the closest city that were closest to the corpse, Yerchatsuat Idehem, they have to wash their hands. Va'anu Va'amru, they have to declare, Yadenu Lashamchu Es Adam Hazeh, we didn't kill this person. Rashi quotes the Gemara, V'chi Alta Alev, did we even consider the possibility that the elders of the Beit Din, the leaders, the spiritual leaders of the city, we actually suspect that they murdered this person? Ella, rather, Rashi quotes the Gemara, Lo ra'inu patrinu b'lo mizonot u'b'lo levaya. We didn't let him leave our city without, first of all, giving him food and without escorting him from our city. Now, giving him food, we can somewhat understand, because if a person is traveling without food, you can see how you could be liable for the fact that he might pass away if he doesn't have food to sustain himself. But escorting him out of the city, the rules of escorting say, walk a person a few amot, a few feet out of the house, out of the city. How does that protect the person from this murder that took place? Why does the kingdom have to say, we did the act of Levaya, we escorted him, we are not responsible for what happened? Says the Maharal, because when you escort the person out of the city, you are showing that the person is part of the city. What does that mean? They have the benefits of the Tzibur, the protection that comes from being part of the greater Am Yisrael and not just being an individual who's doing your own thing. When that person connects himself to the city, the city has given him the protection of the benefit of the merit of the entire city. Yes, there might be individuals that do things that are wrong, but as a whole, as a collective, we do so many wonderful things, and that protects us from the dangers of travel. The Skatim have done their job. We have not spilled that blood. We gave that person the protection of the city, of the public, of the masses. What an amazing lesson we learn over here from what comes when we attach ourselves to the tzibur, when we see ourselves as part of broader Am Yisrael. That is why we start Yom Kippur by saying in the Kol Nidre, by saying before the Kol Nidre, that we're all one people together, everyone. Because when we do that, we have the protection of the tzibur. But if you're out and about and you do not see yourself as part of the Jewish people, you do not see yourself as part of your tzibur, then you're out on your own. And then you have the judgment that comes for you based on your actions alone. And that is certainly not something which we can really withstand. Because each of us does things that are wrong. We need the power and the merit of the tzibur to protect ourselves. Let's make sure, lesson number 8, we connect ourselves to the tzibur. Parshat Shoftim is always read during Elul. Start working on making yourself part of the tzibur so that when the judgment comes, we are judged as being part of the tzibur and not just as individuals. Let's go through all the lessons that we've learned from this week's parsha. Lesson number 1, have judges and policemen b'chol sha'arecha on all of your gates, your eyes, your ears, your mouth, safeguards to make sure that we're dealing with those senses in the proper way and be conscious of what we're saying and hearing and watching and seeing, because those are averot as well. It's not just the actions, but it's what we see, what we hear, how we speak as well. Have those judges in those places. Lesson number 2, lecha, the leaders who are appointing the judges, they are subject to their authority as well. And if we don't have a situation where leaders are subject to the authority of the judges they appoint, we will not have justice in our society. Lesson number 3, shochad, bribery leads the greatest people astray. But if we fight against that bribery, if we remove from ourselves all the selfish interests and desires which lead us to do averot, remove that from the picture, remove the insanity, so to speak, from the picture, then you can be Ovdei Hashem. You'll have the opposite effect. The lack of bribery will lead you towards the truth. Lesson number 4. The Jewish people were told to have a king, but later on they acted improperly because they asked to have a king. Kechol Hagoyim, like all the nations around us, we are supposed to strive to be the Mamlechet Kohanim Megoy Kadosh. We are supposed to strive to be different and then inspire the whole world to come with us. Let's make sure that we are not making decisions in our lives that are motivated by our desire to be like the nation and society around us. Lesson number 5, Tamim Tiyeh Im Hashem Elokecha, when it's just you and God alone, no one else there, it's just you and God. That's the greatest test to see your Eved Hashem. That's where you can reach the highest of levels when you refrain from Avera and you strive to do mitzvot. That is the true test. And let's make sure, lesson number 5, when we are by ourselves, the Chadri Chadarim, that's where we refrain from Averot and we strive to do mitzvot. Lesson number 6, Hashem says you will have a prophet that will come. Me'achicha, says the Sfat Emet. What is that teaching us? The only chance we have of the bracha, of restoring prophecy, of that high level of connection to Hashem, is when we have the key to the bracha. And what is that key? As our cook said, it is achdut. It's the unity of the Jewish people. It's all the Jewish people together. Lesson number 7, when you are besieging a city, do not cut down the trees, caring about the environment of the beautiful world that Hashem has commanded. Like the Midrash says, Hashem told Adam, take care of my beautiful world. Don't allow it to be destroyed. And final lesson number 8, the story of the Egla Arufa. And the Zakenim say, we didn't kill this person. We did the act of Levaya. We escorted him out of the city. We enabled him to be connected to the Tzibor. We have to strive to always be part of the broader Tzibor, of part of Am Yisrael, and have the protection that comes when we're not individuals who all of us do things that are wrong, but we're part of the broader tzibur who does so much good. That is one of the ways that we can merit in Din and Rosh Hashanah, making sure we work during Elul, that we are part of the nation and not acting as separate individuals. Let's try to incorporate one, some, all of the lessons in this week's parsha into our lives. Bezrat Hashem, grow as Ovdei Hashem. Thank you so much for joining us. Wishing everyone a Shabbat Shalom.